Many of you may have experienced doubts about certain future technological advancements. I mean, don't deny it. A fear of technology, of artificial intelligence, of autonomous cars, of factories without workers, of smart robots, it's totally fine. The panic of our jobs being taken away, of a few gaining power at the expense of others, inequalities multiplying, and even machines controlling us and taking over the world, it's scary stuff.
Robot Commando fires his secret weapon. No enemy can destroy him.
Hey, buddy, get rolling!
Take my heart. So, can machines really replace human beings? Could they really manage to teach themselves and take control of civilization? And what role are people gonna play in a world of intelligent machines? Folks, this fear of change, of the unknown, of the future, has become something like our own 21st century phantom. A phantom that is now moving all around the planet. Although, you know what? Truthfully, this is nothing new. The relationship between human beings and machines has never been simple. It has always awakened mixed feelings.
Boom! The eagle has landed. Is that the same noise you heard when you signed your sportswear contract?
Some fear them, and others see them as an opportunity for progress. There are those who view them with distrust, and those who view them as great allies. And of course, there are always those who predict that because of all these machines, the end of humanity is getting nearer. By the way, before I continue, what group do you belong to? Let me know in the comments below. And also, we've got a survey about it at the end of the video, so check that out. And of course, along with all these fears are the typical contradictions that always arise. We protest because the machines take our jobs, and at the same time, we complain about the mundane and exhausting jobs to which many employees are subjected, especially the least qualified ones. Or, for example, another very typical contradiction. Almost every day we hear union leaders demanding a shorter workday, while at the same time rejecting or wanting to halt technology, which, you know, would actually lead to that shorter workday. Then there's one of my favorites. Many politicians continually denounce workers' low purchasing power while they place obstacles and even prohibit technologies that increase productivity and lower prices. Maybe you've thought about the taxi sector and platforms like Uber. We at VisualPolitik certainly have. Of course, DeViewer, in the end, adapting to new changes, it tends to be just a matter of time. Do you know a single person who worries about jobs that have disappeared because of mobile phones? Do you know anyone who wants to ban electric power because it can hurt candle factory workers? Well, it's true. As we mentioned before, the arrival of artificial intelligence has led to some new questions and some new challenges. But before we talk all about that, let's look back at the history.
Fear of change.
Many of the political speeches we hear every day, they pose nothing new. And the alarms raised about technological changes, they come directly from such speeches. See, from the very beginning, from the time human beings lived in caves, humanity has progressed thanks to the use of tools. To hunt, to gather, to cultivate, to conserve food, or to improve productivity, it's all because of tools. Tools have given us the chance to achieve better lives. In fact, nowadays, humanity is experiencing the greatest welfare in all of its history. However, during a particular moment in history, tools and machines became something like an enemy to be beaten, at least for a certain part of society. We're of course talking about the time of the Industrial Revolution. This is despite the fact that the Industrial Revolution meant a huge leap in terms of welfare for billions of people. The fact is that at the time machines began to be used widely, protests against them multiplied, and movements of all kinds emerged against the use of new technologies. The basic argument was that so many machines would leave artisans, workers, and peasants out of work. The most famous of these reactions was that of the Luddites, who, at the beginning of the 19th century, promoted attacks against factories, and especially against machines. They hated them with all their might, and of course had to destroy them because a world with machines would be terrible. Between you and me, let's just say that thank goodness they didn't get their way. I mean, can you really imagine what life would be like? But before we continue, here's a question. What do you think about trains? Do you like them? Do you think they're useful? Or maybe you consider them dangerous? The chances are you probably think that they're worth having around. Well, the 8th president of the United States, President Martin Van Buren, he wouldn't agree with you. As Michael Cox and Richard Alm tell us in their book, Myths of the Rich and Poor, Why We're Better Off Than We Think, in 1829, Martin Van Buren was very concerned about the dangers of the railroad. He was so concerned that he even wrote to President Andrew Jackson to ask him to push a railroad ban. Yep, you heard that right. Martin Van Buren thought that the railroad would risk the jobs of thousands of people who worked in deliveries and in canals and boat construction. In fact, since Van Buren also thought that ships were essential to defend the United States, he considered the railroad to be a serious threat to national security. And that's not all. In that same letter addressed to President Andrew Jackson, Van Buren also warned about the danger of a transportation system that moved a whopping 24 kilometers per hour. So yes, these arguments, they do seem a bit ridiculous nowadays, but at the time, many people took these ideas very seriously. And okay, it's true, technological changes have caused difficulties throughout history. Think, for example, about what happens with the development of telecommunications. See, when telephony became massive in its early days, when you wanted to talk to someone, you gave an operator the name and surname of the person you wanted to talk to.
Rita, would you quote the charges on this for me, please?
One moment, please.
So by the second half of the 20th century, which really wasn't so long ago, tens of thousands of operators worked connecting long-distance calls. This, of course, made the calls very expensive.
StarTag, the world's smallest, lightest cellular phone.
I can't even see the battery.
What other phone could you wear like this?
Motorola! I mean, who else could have done it?
However, by 1980, technology allowed communications to be made directly, without any intermediaries. Suddenly, the operators became irrelevant and calls became very, very cheap. So the question is, what happened to all of the operators? Well, they had to find new jobs. And yes, I know, adapting isn't always easy, but evidently this change in telephony was very beneficial for society as a whole. Communications, they became easier and much cheaper. That's why the important thing is to generate lots of employment opportunities within a society and make it relatively easy to change jobs. Can you just imagine if a state, if a government had forbidden these positions from disappearing? That country's communications would still be very slow. People would sometimes have to wait hours to speak with someone, and calls would be very expensive. All of this would have made the economy and the total number of jobs in that country not very good. Because, folks, we tend to forget one thing. Now, as you watch this video, you're going through the time in history where technology is used the most. And you know what? It's also the time where people work the most. In fact, it's curious, but the countries that use the most robots are precisely those that suffer the least unemployment, which is definitely not a bad thing. Now, some of you might be thinking, come on, Simon, artificial intelligence, that's going to be different. Well, let's dive into that.
Are you listening? Damn.
The time of AI.
Yeah.
Dear viewer, the time of artificial intelligence and robots, it's already here. Every day we use more products and more services that function with artificial intelligence, from voice assistants to the autonomous cars that are already beginning to circulate. And yes, the speed with which this intelligence progresses is certainly impressive. We could say that artificial intelligence involves applying the enormous power of computers to solve problems. Well, in the last 30 years, the cost of computing capacity, it became 200 million times cheaper. To give you an idea of what this means, we could say that if the car industry's cost had evolved in the same way today, a high-end car would cost only 4/10,000ths of what it does now. This would make it cheaper than a single Venezuelan bolivar. And yes, the bolivar under Nicolas Maduro.
Muy bonito en su diseño, además. Déjeme decir, bolívar de oro.
This evolution is precisely what explains why today a PlayStation 4 costs less than $400, even if it is about 2,000 times more powerful than the Cray 2 supercomputer, one of the most famous computers in history, which beat all records back in 1984. And this computer, unlike the PlayStation 4, weighed 2.5 tons and cost $18 million. Today, a PlayStation 4 can perform 1.84 trillion floating-point operations per second. This would take a person approximately 60,000 years to do. And it's precisely this enormous calculation capacity that allows AIs to replace us in several tasks. For example, sooner or later, the autonomous car will end up imposing itself. We simply won't be able to compete with its calculation abilities, especially now that these machines have managed to perceive their environment thanks to cameras, microphones, and sensors. So yes, based on how things are evolving, it seems almost certain that in a relatively short time, many mechanical and routine jobs from factories to the field will be carried out by smart machines. But this means that productivity will increase a lot, and with it, that also means most people's well-being will also increase.
I think in the next 30 years, people will only work 4 hours a day and maybe 4 days a week. My grandfather worked 16 hours a day in the farmland, and he thought he was very busy. We work 8 hours, 5 days a week, and we think we are very busy. Jack Ma, chairman of Alibaba.
And no doubt, during this time, many new jobs will be created of all kinds. Because, you see, the question we may want to ask ourselves is, how close are the machines to surpassing us? Well, for some tasks, they're really close, but for many, not really. You see, machines can compute very quickly, but they have problems learning. Computers are very inefficient learners. They only recognize patterns after analyzing something an overwhelming number of times. And this is humanity's great advantage.
The most advanced machine learning systems require thousands of examples to acquire new concepts, while humans can generalize from a few examples. Many animals can learn from a limited number of experiences, but humans seem particularly good at generalizing based on just a few experiences. Greg Corrado, Stanford neuroscientist and director of augmented intelligence at Google.
This explains why nowadays humans are far superior in areas such as creativity, innovation, intuition, and empathy. Folks, nobody can predict the future, but until now, machines have always meant more jobs and better welfare for all. In the near future, it's almost certain that what is already happening will continue to happen. Some jobs will be destroyed and many others will be created. Not only highly qualified ones, but jobs of all kinds. And probably working hours will decrease and real wages will increase. Beyond that, it's very hard to predict what may or may not happen, but let's not fall into the same mistakes that former US President Martin Van Buren fell into during his fear and rejection of the railroad. There are still many challenges to overcome in the world, such as poverty and environmental sustainability, and the machines, they can really help us a lot. But now it's your turn. What's your perspective on AI? Do leave your comments below as well as in this survey. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. Please do hit like if you did, and don't forget to subscribe for brand new videos. Also, don't forget to check out our friends at the Reconsider Media podcast. They provided the vocals in this episode that were not mine. Also, this channel is made possible because of our patrons on Patreon. Please consider joining them and supporting our mission of providing independent political coverage. And as always, thank you for watching.
Muy bonito en su diseño, además. Déjame decir, Bolívar de Oro.
StarTag, the world's smallest, lightest cellular phone.
I can't even see the battery.
What other phone could you wear like this? Motorola! I mean, who else could have done it?